My name is Ann Summers, and I'm on the faculty of the University of Georgia in Athens. And I teach microbiology, and I do research using microorganisms. I've been working for, let's say since 1969 on mercury as a subject of interest. I began working on this when I was a doctoral student at Washington University in St. Louis. Up until the late 80s, I had worked on mercury strictly as a phenomenon of bacterial resistance. And it was a nice model system. You could do all kinds of physiology and biochemistry, and it was fun to do and easy to work on. And we had lots of interest from NIH and NSF in supporting. And I remember very distinctly, it was a winter afternoon in December, I think, that I happened to flip open a copy of the FASEB journal, which is a general life sciences, medically oriented journal. And I saw this paper, which had a picture of a sheep with radio autography, a demonstration of all the mercury that was in this sheep. And I thought, wow, that's really strange. And it was their very first paper, which was published in the FASEB J, and showed that when you put fillings into an animal, that the mercury goes everywhere. In some places more than others, as has been pointed out, in the jaw and in the kidney and so forth, and particularly in the GI tract, in the gut, in other words. And so I picked up the phone at that point, and I called Fritz Lohrscheider, and I said I'd found his study very interesting and that I'd worked on mercury and bacteria, and I asked him if he knew anything about mercury-resistant bacteria. And he said he'd never heard of such a thing. So we had a conversation that ended up in establishing a plan to go forward to collaborate with him, because they'd already begun to work on the monkeys. They did all of the housing of the animals and the feeding of the animals and so forth up in Calgary, and they put the fillings in a regular dental operatory and so forth that they had there. So, and then they sent us the samples of monkey feces, freshly collected each day, or actually twice a week. We then immediately did bacteriological work on them that allowed us to see the two things that we were particularly interested in were how many of the microorganisms that we were cultivating. And we cultivated three different types of bacteria from the monkey feces. And we had a way to figure out how many of them were mercury resistant and what proportion were mercury resistant of the total, and what proportion also carried antibiotic resistance genes. And the reason we were interested in asking that question was because we already knew, the whole world knew, that the genes for mercury resistance, I should say the whole world of microbiome, well, I should actually say the small world of people interested in antibiotic resistance in bacteria knew that the genes for mercury resistance were carried on bacterial plasmids, which also carried antibiotic resistance genes. And now bacterial plasmids are little supernumerary chromosomes that bacteria can kind of exchange with each other, like sort of like little apps that you can exchange with your friends that allow you to be resistant to things. And so the mercury resistance genes being on the same plasmids as antibiotic resistance genes, if you expose a bacterial community to antibiotics, of course, that will cause the bacteria to persist as antibiotic resistance bacteria. And people were concerned about that already, because they knew that overuse of antibiotics was causing a prevalence and spread of antibiotic multi-resistance in humans, which is a problem. And we were interested in this experiment to see whether or not exposure of animals with their microorganisms to mercury, resulting in the exposure of the microbes themselves to mercury, would cause a persistence and prevalence not only of the mercury resistance, but also of the antibiotic resistance because of genetic linkage. If you pick the mercury resistance, you can carry along the antibiotic resistance as well. So that was the purpose of those experiments. And that paper was published in Antimicrobial Agents and Chemotherapy in April of 93. And it made the case that exposure of these primates, which are a reasonably good model for human biology and microbiology, to mercury resulted in a proliferation of microbes in their gut that had both mercury resistance and multiple antibiotic resistances. And that in the early monkeys that we worked with them on, the fillings were taken out after 2 months. And so we could see a decline in mercury-resistant bacteria and antibiotic multi-resistant bacteria after that period. So that clearly associated them with the exposure to mercury in of the microbiota of the animals that we were looking at. And the animals didn't have any exposure to any other mercury. And in a couple of the cases, they were working with radioactive mercury, so it wasn't an issue of, you know, getting the mercury from their diet or anything like that. But they also were not, of course, eating fish. And we arranged with them ahead of time that the monkeys were, the kind of animal chow that they had no antibiotics in it. Because there are some laboratory chows which are amended with antibiotics so that the animals will not come down with something while they're doing an experiment on something else. So we have data on the development of mercury and multiple antibiotic resistance in the normal flora, and that included both the oral flora as well as the GI tract flora in these animals that had amalgam fillings, and the only source of mercury was from the amalgam fillings. And so in all those cases, there was a proliferation of antibiotic multi-resistance along with mercury resistance subsequent to the installation of the fillings. And it was statistically significant. We did statistics on those data, and it was a statistically significant difference after the installation of the amalgams for both the mercury resistance and the antibiotic resistance.